Thank you. Good evening, everybody. It's about 7:01 by my clock, and I'd like to call the meeting of our regularly scheduled Marquette Township Board meeting to order. It's August 3rd. We're Wednesday because of yesterday's election. So if everybody would join us in the Pledge of Allegiance, I would appreciate it.
Pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, Randy, please.
Trustee LaRue.
Here.
Trustee Trescott.
Here.
Trustee Pompo.
Here.
Trustee Marks.
Present.
Treasurer Johnson.
Here.
Clerk Retire is here, and Supervisor Durant.
Here.
Staff present is Manager Gerard and our Township Attorney, Roger Zappa. Committee members here are Mike Springer from Recreation and Roads and Dave Wiegen from Planning, Recreation and Roads. And Dan Everson's here from the Fire Department tonight.
Thanks, Randy. Next on the agenda is approval of the consent agenda, which typically consists of approval of the regular minutes of July 19th and the special meeting minutes of July 25th. Received committee and other reports, including a memo from our Yell regarding the Marquette County Solid Waste Management Authority report and draft minutes from their July 20th meeting. Fire Department officers meeting draft minutes of July 11th, as well as their business meeting of the same day. Road committee agenda for August 3rd, approved minutes from June 7th, and draft minutes from July 12th of this year. And utility billing, August 2016 calendar, that we'll talk about later. Correspondence not requiring board action is correspondence from Thomas Baldini regarding the 4th of July, which was a nice thank you. And bills payable in the amount of $129,567.84, plus the financial statements from June and the treasurer's report from June. Yes,
move
Randy.
To approve.
Second.
Before that.
He did have his hand up, John, sorry.
Trustee Pompo had brought to my attention, he had sent a correspondence that for the motion that we had during the special meeting in regards to the counter offer for the property. And I do remember this. He noticed that the addition was not there, and the addition was if the counter offer was accepted upon receipt of the money minus commission, the remainder of the money would immediately be paid to the principal of the loan of the Township Hall. And I do remember that. So I do think it would be correct to add that to that.
So moved.
So I will add that. We don't have to have a change. It'll just be as an amended consent agenda.
Okay, and this is the July 19th minutes.
Yeah.
Correct? Okay. Yeah, no, the special meeting minutes.
Special meeting of the 25th, it would be.
And the board is already on record taking that position when you approve the sale.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I will make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended with the change of the minutes of July 25th.
Support.
Motion and support, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you for that. Next is the approval of the agenda. We have a couple changes. First of all, we don't need the closed session tonight, so you can scratch that off.
Good.
Good. We're not getting out at 10 after, though, sorry. And I'd like to add, as what you had at your place when you came in, a memo from Manager Gerard about the fire department liaison. And I'll talk a little bit about that in my board member comments. So that would be, I suppose, new business? Mm-hmm. 10 G or H? 10 H? Yep. Believe. Did you have anything, Randy?
No, I do not for this. agenda.
Okay, we just need a motion then, please.
I make a motion, we approve the regular agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion and support, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Next is public comment. If anybody would like to address the board before we get into our business, come forward and give us your name and address, please. Or an iPad. Let's make sure everybody's phones are off, please. I forgot to mention that.
Okay, Mike, here should be ready to go.
Is this on?
It's on. Yep.
Yes. Next slide, please. I want to make the board aware of a public hearing that's coming up in August 10th at 7 p.m. It's at the Planning Commission meeting. Also, I'm doing this because we really need the public involved in this. So I'm hoping that this information gets out. People watch it on YouTube and gets out to the public. Next, please. What we're looking at, the Planning Commission at their last meeting last Wednesday took a look at a text amendment to design standards ordinance that they're working on right now. And what this, in part, and what I'm going to focus on is the development and the support of what our master plan is and our complete streets ordinance and what we've been doing. So next slide, please. Next slide. We've had some input from a planning commissioner, next slide, and some input from a developer. So far we only have two sides or two different individuals giving us some input. So what we're after is we need people that want to support the master plan, want to support complete streets, and want to support the development of trails in the township. We need those people to come to the Planning Commission meeting next August the 10th. Next slide, please. You know, we look closely, and that's our job in government, is really to do what the citizens of this community want. And so we look at the surveys and what they want have done. And this one right here, you can see that people support the development of biking and walking. Some other things there too. Next slide, please. Now, the master plan is built on what the citizens want. And this is the master plan that was basically created by the Planning Commission and supported by this board. And this really should be our Bible. Our strategic plan and our master plan and all our plans should be what we're moving forward with in this community unless we are going to update them or modify them. So, next slide, please. Note at the bottom of the master plan, we have at least considered smart growth principles. There's 10 principles, and one of them is complete, or one of them is create walkable communities. These are ideas that have been going on for 30 years and how they make a community a better place to live. We also, because we were the first township in the Upper Peninsula to develop a complete streets and adopt a complete streets ordinance, we also are part of the Michigan Complete Streets Coalition. And I can tell you a lot more about the millennials and placemaking and a lot of things that are really, we want to attract the mobile class. We want to attract people that are educated and can do their job from any place in the world. And this is one of the types of amenities that they're looking for. They want non-pedestrian, or they want non-motorized access. They want a bicycle, they want to hike, they want to do lots of different outdoor sports. Next slide. And this is from our rec plan. And you can see that in 2018, although it's probably going to be 2019, we have plans to put, and it's all proposed right now, nothing's set in stone, and we have to wait for a plan from Brinkerhoff, and that's probably not going to happen until the middle of October, and the DDA has to look at it, and A lot of people have to look at it, but we are moving forward with plans to try to put an underpass under US 41, a safe crossing. Next slide, please. And this is our Schwemwood Park right here. And we bought this property in 2011 because, first of all, the township came up with match money, and the public, businesses, organizations, and individuals came up with over $15,000 to help purchase that property. That's a trailhead. And so what our idea is, this is where our idea is, to take it down at the lowest place and go underneath the road and connect this side. And it's to connect to the NTN trailhead up in Northville. But we see this area as it being very beneficial to this area. People, retail shops, access that in a non-motorized way. Okay, next slide, please. Here are some of the people that support this. I mean, they gave financially to make this happen. You know, so the need is there, people are demonstrating the need, but this is an expensive way to go because the township had to use taxpayers' money in part for the match money, and we had to raise $15,000 in order to purchase that property. Next, please. Well, that was interesting. So again, we need comments. We need comments about how do we put some language in this design standards that shifts the responsibility from the township using taxpayer money and also having to raise funds? How do we shift this to the businesses that want to do, people that want to do business in our community? And so we're asking the public to come out to this public hearing and speak their mind. If you're interested in complete streets and you want to be able to walk places, you want to be able to bicycle places, then you're going to need to come here and let the Planning Commission know that. So some of the things that have already been taken out of the text, from what I've heard, is things like ADA compliant. Using words, and not just words, but understanding the design principles of the ADA and universal design and barrier-free access. These are all things that anybody that's building a building right now, now this day and age, they really need to take into consideration. You want to be able to have your business open to all people of all ages and abilities. So this is really important. And it may seem like it's just a text amendment, but this is what, this becomes the guide, because this is part of an ordinance. This is part of an ordinance, correct? It's a design standard ordinance. So this becomes the law. And so this is where we can get developers to understand that we're serious about non-motorized transportation. We're serious about alternative modes of transportation. And so if you would, as a board member, if you have time, on Wednesday, the 10th of August, we'd really like to see you there. And again, anybody that you know in the community that's interested in seeing more non-motorized transportation, seeing this underpass go through, we can't go to MDOT and ask for a $2 million underpass if we don't have places that it's going to connect. So we've got to have these connections either in the works or there already. So this is real important, just if not for anything else, to get this underpass, to bring it to fruition. So your support, support of the community is really important. And here's, again, you know, developers are probably gonna be there, you know, because it does initially gonna cost a little bit more money. Even though the cost of some of these developments are multi-million and it's not that much to put in walkways, you know, there's still people that are going to find fault with that. But it's the wave of the future. It's if we want this to be, if we want our economy to keep growing, if we want to attract talented people that'll bring, build industries here and bring jobs with them, then this is the way we need to go. One more slide, please. So again, to the public and anybody else that can be there, August the 10th at 7 p.m. We'd appreciate it. One more thing. The road committee just reached a consensus to support this stronger language in that. We just met. And of course, the rec committee, it's in our rec plan. We've been advocates of complete streets and non-motorized transportation for a long time.
Thanks, Mike.
There's not going to be a representative here tonight from UPEA. I told Mark I'd take care of the update on item 9A. And then I'd also like to speak on item 10D, representing the road committee.
Road committee.
9A and 10B.
10B. Thanks. Anybody else wish to address the board? Seeing none, we will go on to board member comment. Anybody have anything they want to share? Not Pete. Priming.
I didn't say nothing.
Microphone. Go ahead.
I just want to remind people that we most be close that they see it on Thursday or whatever, but Community Days is coming Saturday at the Lions Recreation Area over behind Vanderbilt School. We've got lots of things going on. We have baseball games going to be Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Most of the events will be on Saturday. It's going to start at 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock in that area until about 9:30 at night. We have three different bands. For the children, we have the state police coming in with the fingerprints, voice print, and you know all that stuff. And the parents will be able to have a disc, take home with a disc with them. So they have that for safekeeping. We're going to have the fire department there, and we're going to have, I believe, the Coast Guard?
Possibly.
Going to be there. We're going to have similar, like, bouncy houses and stuff like that. It's going to be there. There's so many things going on, and just tell your friends, tell your neighbors, anyone, everyone you can talk to about coming up. This year's one of our bigger years, and so it's going to be more than we have in the past, so... It's going to be a great time, so just make sure you tell everyone you see. Just see you Saturday, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock at the Lions Recreation Area. And I'd like to thank Mike for the nice presentation. We had a good discussion at our meeting before this at the Road Committee, and he's right when he says it will attract different people and attract, you know, higher dollar volume houses if you want or whatever, but it's a thing that's coming. I mean, it's a thing in the past. People are thinking different than we did. We get in a car and go down the road. Now they get on their bike and ride or walk. So I think you did a nice job, Mike, and we'll try to get as many people we can to be at the Planning Commission meeting. So thank you.
Thanks, Pete. There will be food, right, too, on Saturday?
Yes.
At Lions Field?
Yeah, right. The only thing we won't have any adult refreshments. You have to bring your own.
Okay. Oh, but so they can bring their
own. They can bring their own.
Okay. All right.
Provided the board lifts the policy for this event. You have a no alcohol policy at the park. The board has to take an action to exempt this event from it.
Then we should add that to the agenda too.
You should probably do that tonight.
Yeah.
Okay, let's finish board member comment first then.
Dan,
go ahead.
I'd like to give
an update on the Marquette Township Fire Department race team. Consisting of Jeff Sims, Randy Mackala, Matt Portage, Brett Bridges, Jesse Nye, and coaches Dan Chang and Andy Linsmeyer.
Dan, turn on your microphone, please. Thanks.
Okay. Should I go over it again?
Yeah, you better start.
Okay, I'll go over it again. The Township Fire Department race team consisting of Jeff Sims, Randy Mackala, Matt Portage, Brett Bridges, Jesse Nye, and coaches Dan Shanahan and Andy Linsmeyer. They took overall a second at the champion tournament. They took second overall in the Marquette 4th of July tournament. They took a first overall in the Nagani Pioneer Days. And just this past weekend, they took a third overall at the UP tournaments. So they well represented the township at the UP tournaments. That would be third out of, I believe it was 18 or 19 teams that raced. So just to give that update, congratulations.
Okay, thanks. Randy, you had your hand up before?
Yeah, I'll give, since the election was yesterday, I'd like to thank all the voters that came out, percentage-wise, in Precinct 1, which is the bigger precinct north of US 41. We had a 28% turnout. And on Precinct 2, the south of 41, we had 38%. So averaged out probably about 31%, 32% with both precincts. And we've been averaging past elections probably about 22%, 23%. So we are up, so that's good. Hopefully splitting precincts has helped people vote, easier to vote for them. And the election went pretty well. I did have a small snafu, but we got through that, and we're moving on to November. So I'll give the dates and the future meetings when you have to be registered to vote for the November election. And again, I thought Precinct 1, which is St. Christopher's, the voters did pretty well getting there considering the a maze of construction in the area, and hopefully that'll be done by November. And again, I would encourage anyone able to absentee vote to do that. And it's the applications that if you did fill them out for the primary and you did check that for the presidential, you'll be getting an application to vote in the mail soon, probably by September, and we'll have the ballots printed by September. So you should be getting ballots by the end of September for November already. And a quick update on the November election. A federal judge has just recently injuncted the straight party voting. So I don't know where that's going to go. So they took it away initially, and the federal judge put an injunction on it. So if nothing changes, it will be back on the November election. So I'll try to keep you updated as much as I can. However, they have to make a decision soon because ballots are going to be printed in September. So that's all I have, unless anyone has any questions.
How did we do on absentees? You were kind of hoping that that was, is it a good percentage? Or
we had, I believe, about 100 in each precinct, which for a primary is about right. So I had about 250 for total for both. In the November election passed, we've had about 700-800. So hopefully if history comes forward, I'm looking for maybe 8 to 1,000. So hopefully we'll have that. And like I said, I encourage people to do it. It's a very easy way to vote, and you have a lot of time to look at the ballot and make decisions.
So now when they signed up for this election, they can do an absentee in November also?
Yeah, there was on this application that they had, there was two checks on there, and a lot of them checked for November also. So we kept a copy of that. So we will be contacting the voters when, you know, that time is necessary to get their ballots for the November one.
Good. Okay. Did you have a question, Pete?
One question for Randy. With all the signs out there, Randy, how long do they have
to take them? They should be up picked up by 2 days. I think if they're not picked up by 5 days, people will start picking them up for them. And I don't know where they're going to go from there. So if you have any election signs out, I would get them as soon as possible, because I think after a week they're going to be fair game for anyone to take. So pick them up, and there's a lot of them out there still, as I saw today. So hopefully the candidates will get them as soon as possible.
Okay. Yes, John.
The clerk's office also has another courtesy that they offer for folks that want to be on a continuous list of always getting absentee ballots. They keep that list and they replace those each time there's an election. So for those that know that they're going to be doing that, it's a good thing and it's a courtesy, and for that we thank the clerk.
Yeah, that's called the permanent absent voter list. And if you basically, if you're over 60 or if you're going to be out of town a lot, you can talk to Lois and get added to that. And basically what will happen is every election, we will send you an application to vote. So you'll get one for every election that we have. So.
Good. Thanks, John. That's good information. Anybody else? Ernie, do you have anything?
No, I have nothing.
A couple things to cover. That I've even already added. Yeah, I want to thank everybody too who came out to vote. It's hard to do a primary because most people don't think it's important, but you don't realize that every vote counts. Now, you could be a swing vote. How do you know? So thank you for those who took the time to out of their schedule to go out. You did get, speaking of voting, you did get an insert in your water bill, your utility bill. I don't know, it's kind of small, John, but maybe you could zoom in on it. And I asked staff to put this in to give you an idea. You're going to have a lot of ballot questions this year in November. So if you saw the back of your utility bill, it went back on the calendar in the back. We had it printed. So just as an example, and I guess I didn't bring it. I copied my own tax bill, and I guess I didn't stick it in here. Because there are probably 10, 12 items on your tax bill that you're charged that are going to be on this next ballot in November. And I hate to list them off because I won't do it justice, but, oh, maybe you know, Randy, 911, the veterans.
Library. All of the county millages. The county millages will be on, the Honor Heritage Trail Library. So there's going to be a number of millage questions.
There's a huge list of those that you're paying for in your taxes. And that's okay, but I want you to try to be more responsible as to what you choose, what's important to you. Just as an example, if you look at this list, we know that the Iron Ore Heritage Trail asks for a 0.2 mil, okay? So if you have a $100,000 home, on your taxes, you're going to pay $20.20 for the whole year to support the Heritage Trail, okay? If you have a $250,000 home, it's going to cost you $50. So some of the items on the tax bill, you know, might have been 0.55 mils. So you can get a rough idea that what's listed on here is a 0.2 mil, 0.5, 1 mil, like for the library. So if you have a $100,000 home, you're paying $101 a year to support the library. If that's important to you, that's great. You're going to want to check that box or fill it in. Excuse me, Randy. We don't want to check it. If you have a $250,000 home, you're going to pay $252.50 a year to support the library. And I picked those two just because I remember them. But there's, like I said, 911 and the veterans and, I'm sorry, I don't remember a lot of them. Medical facility, the VA. Yep. Well, the school, of course, is on there. They have three or four different ones. Yep. And then there's 1.5 mil. So you've got four different things. Once you see the ballot, it might be a good idea to sit down and say, okay, what's my tax bill going to be for these items? And yes, I definitely want to support these. And then that's what you're going to fill in. Take it to the ballot, to the election. So I just wanted to point that out. I thought that was very important. And staff was great about helping me put that together to envision what I was looking for. So I think that's very important. The other thing on the staff side was our assessor and her, I hate to say assistant, because they're almost equally trained. Just went through an equalization hearing, and it's the first one since this assessor has been in place, she said. So they had years worth of fixes and updates and stuff that they've been working on diligently, the two of them, and we got a really good report back from the state. I was real proud of them, and that's, you know, partly my responsibility, even though I'm not a certified assessor, it still falls to me to follow that. And there were very few, it's just one page letter, and there were two or three or four things that they recommended, and we've already implemented a lot of them. Some things are software related, so they've contacted the software supporter and asked for different reports, and I just want to give them kudos, because keeping our taxes and our assessment part of it up to date is pretty important to make sure we have everything right, not only for us but for the public. And that goes with making sure those who are exempt are tracked properly, and if they have the homestead, you know, making sure all that stuff is right. So I want to thank them for all the hard work they did on that. I had asked that, and thanks, Dan, for some of the update on the Fireman's Tournament. I had asked the Assistant Fire Chief to come and give us a report, because that is an educational thing that we've supported. So maybe I'll catch the Assistant Chief. I did mention it to the Chief to ask him to have him bring us a report. So maybe we can catch him for the next meeting. You did get some information on, if you remember last meeting, Mr. Jandrin came and spoke to us about some of the developing he's doing. So you did get an update in your emails about what that might look at like. So we'll probably have that on the next agenda for discussion, just so that you're aware. And if you go through all of that information at the very end, the last page has the details of the fees, and that's what he'd like to see us consider. One more thing, let's see, millage questions, we talked about that. The fire department liaison, I asked that to be on the agenda tonight, because when Manager Gerard and I visit about what's happening going forward, we're constantly thinking about fun things to talk about on our agendas, of course. But there are really only four liaison positions that the township is responsible for, and that's some of the research I did to find out what I'm going to be responsible for. I'm assuming, I hate to assume, going forward with appointments. So planning is something that's required to have a liaison to that position. The Iron Ore Heritage Rec Authority is the second one, because we are paying millage to that, so we need that connector. And I'm while we do get lots of minutes and financial reports and stuff from them, I'm going to talk to our representative and have him try to get here a little more frequently than just maybe once a year and talk to us about what they're doing. The ZBA and the Board of Review are something else we have to have connections to, and in most cases that's me. So we've covered the statutory requirements for having a connection to those organizations that are part of the township. So what I'm also going to propose, probably to the next board, would be that we have a representative from this board attend the meetings for the library and the Solid Waste Authority, because those are, again, just like the Heritage Trail, we are helping to fund them, and we need information back and forth. We need to have a representative, in my mind, from this group attend and bring our views to those organizations, and counterwise, get information back from them, although we do get, you know, minutes and everything like that. So that's something I'm going to propose. So when we talked about the fire department liaison, the research we came up with was that it was just something that was created, and partly because there is no, there was really no full-time fire chief, and there was no, the information wasn't as easy to obtain. And I had talked to, when we reappointed or changed the appointment, I guess, of the fire marshal to the fire chief and changed those departments, I had talked to Chief DeMars about coming to the meetings quarterly or monthly or every meeting or something and giving us a report. So that's part of the discussion that I want to have going forward at this meeting, to see how the board feels about that. But I wanted to give you some background. I could have saved it too for that agenda item, but I wanted the public to know why that was on the agenda. So those are the only things I have to share for right now. So if nobody has any questions for me, Yes, Randy.
Not a question, but the Iron Ore Heritage Trail millage was on the ballot yesterday, and it was approved by about, I think, 700 votes to 300, so it was like a 70% approval. So that will be on your next tax bill, because that was approved.
Mm-hmm. And that's why they chose.
Yeah, 0.2 mil, and no, that does not go to November, because they asked for the August election, and they were actually a year early. So we granted them that, so now they are all set for, I think, is it 4, 5, 6 years, I think?
Six, it was. It should be six.
Yeah, 6 years, so they're good for 6 years.
Good. And some of the reason for them coming on early was budget reasons and the way their finances are structured when they get the money from the communities. So, okay, that's the end of board member comment. We can get into, we don't have a forum discussion. I kind of usurped that by adding it on. Unfinished business, Dave, if you want to give us, or Randy, if he'd talk to any of our road people, that would be great for an update.
Yeah, I did talk to Mark from UPEA. He wasn't going to be able to be here tonight, but some things I can pass on to you is the 2015 road rehabilitation work that was being done, that we had the punch list that we gave him a couple weeks ago. That's reported that Payne and Dolan is done with that checklist. For the 2016 road rehab that's going on primarily on Trowbridge, Baco is scheduled to start that project on August the 15th, which is just about 12 days away. He said that he will have the letters out to the affected residents within a week. And the 2016 portion of South Vandenboom that is being done, they've started on the water main on Monday. They're still moving ahead with that project. Both the 2016 project in Trowbridge and the 2016 project on South Vandenboom is scheduled to be completed by October 15th. Awesome. Unless you have any questions, that's it.
Any questions for Dave or even the manager? They both kind of...
Are we on schedule, Dave?
Yep.
Pretty much so.
So far.
So far.
Lynn, just a
yes,
just a comment, and we got this a lot yesterday at the election, and I did have to explain to the voters that the Ontario project was not the township project. So if they had any concerns, to talk to the county of Marquette over that. The township project, as I told them, is moving along quite well. The county project, unfortunately, seems to have slowed down, so.
Randy, you had something to add to?
Yeah, the only other thing I would add is that in addition to those projects, we also have the Safe Route to School project that's going on, and that is the pathway that's being added to Commerce Drive and Venture Drive. That is also a township project.
Yep. I just wanted to let people know that because of the construction in Ontario, the store is still open, and Fat Boys is open also, so you can come from the west and come in there, so they would appreciate your support, because you know they've had a hard winter all summer, so
that's
hard.
Good.
Winter, hard summer.
Okay, anything else about the roads? Okay, we can move on to Catch the Vision poster. Is there something new, Pete, that you wanted to add? Or
no, I just want people to show up, bring your lawn chairs, and enjoy the whole day. You know, we've got events for the whole day, kids and adults. So
with just a couple of quick comments on it, the music, people have been asking about the music that's lined up. Between noon and 3, Jim and Ray will be playing. Excuse me, between 3 and 6, the Flat Broke Blues Band will be playing. And between 6:30 and 9:30, The Reveal, who's been there before prior years, will be playing again, real popular band. So that will be going on. We will have the inflatables for the kids, and they'll be located right behind center field, primarily by the scoreboard. Lots of activities. The state police program, just to clarify what that is the state police will be creating an identity kit for the children, and basically that entails filling out a form that goes on file. It entails the children being fingerprinted and photos being taken, and all of that being uploaded to a CD that the parents will take with them for safekeeping, safe deposit box or whatever, so that if the child ever is unaccounted for or goes missing, they'll have all of that information to be able to provide to the police. So it is. It's an awesome program.
And that's free, right?
It is free. That is free. Pete forgot to mention there's going to be a dunk tank there.
Yes.
So we'll have some targets in the dunk tank, as well as...
Volunteers, looking for volunteers.
Look elsewhere.
Dennis is not here anymore.
And there'll be face painting going on, a lot of activities for the kids. And, you know, I think they'll enjoy it this year. We're going to have the giant slide, which they really liked. And this year, instead of the bounce house, because we had some issues with kids getting a little overly tired in the bounce house and possibly having, bouncing into each other, we have this year, we have the second one will be an obstacle course. And it has been used previously. The city had it in Matson Park, and it was real popular with the kids as well. It's an inflatable obstacle course. So lots of things to do. We'll also be having, the fire department will be sponsoring, along with the sheriff's department, the Neighbors Noon Out between noon and 4 o'clock at the Lions Field as well. So it's a variety of activities that are going on. Come on down. Bring your chairs with you, lawn chairs, and have some fun.
Have some food.
Okay.
Fat Boys is providing the food, so they'll be there as well.
Randy?
Since this is probably the appropriate time for this, I will make a motion to waive the non-alcohol policy from noon to 10 p.m. at the Lions Field for that day.
Second that.
Ernie, comment?
Who's going to be overseeing it?
I'll be there. Building and grounds will be there.
I mean, who's making the request to do it?
We have to do it. If you're bringing stuff in, it's a...
Yeah, we have a blanket policy that alcohol is not allowed at Lions Field unless the board waives that policy for an event.
It's waived from noon to 10 that day.
We also have sheriff's department people there, so...
No one will be selling it. It'll be all carry-ins.
It's only if you want to carry your own in. The sheriff's department will be there for the whole day, which they usually are. They always are, just to be present with the community. I believe it's going to be Deputy Loonsfoot, who is our former township officer, will be there. 131, I believe, is going to be there as well. The sheriff's department will be providing some of the search and rescue equipment as well. For a display, possibly with Coast Guard, as Pete mentioned. It's hard for them to commit too far in advance. They never know what's going to be happening, but if they can be, they'll be there.
So do we have to worry about whether it's inside or outside the fence of
no.
The area, or not? It's not so much
no,
fence,
because the roads are closed off. The roads, and I'll mention this now, we do have a permit from the Road Commission to close Cherry and Summit between Erie and Woodridge. So they will be non-traffic. So whether inside the fence or outside the fence is not an issue. Our fire department will be there. All of the emergency services agencies have been notified. And with regard to accessing, because of Ontario being torn up, we are suggesting that folks would come from Fair Avenue. If you're coming from the east, use Fair Avenue to Erie to access by Vandenboom School. We do have the approval from the Marquette Area Public Schools to utilize the parking areas at Vandenboom School. And if you're coming from north or west, Wright Street to Ontario, and you can bring Ontario up to Fair, but you can't go north of Fair. I'm sorry, south of Fair. So several different avenues to get there.
Do we need to worry about checking IDs then, since they're on our property? Or
we don't.
Sheriff's Department.
No, we don't. It's personal. The Sheriff's Department, as I say, will be there, and if they observe possible underage drinking, they will be dealing with that. Or a little bit of maybe a little too much in the hot weather, they'll also be there to help with that. I'm not saying, to get aggressive or anything, but just to monitor it.
Good. So that helps us. So we have a motion and second. Anything else? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thanks. Yeah, thanks for shooting that in then. New business. Consider resolution for public inspection of township assessing record. Who's going to cover this for us?
I can speak to this. The assessor came to me. This is part of one of the fixes on what they call the IMR report. Even though we are open 40 hours a week to have inspection of assessing records, we have to have a resolution for that. So it's before you this evening. I'll make a motion to approve the resolution as stated. And it's basically saying that we are open Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, for inspection of assessing records.
Support.
Motion and support. Any questions for Randy or anybody? OK, Okay.
Can we roll call vote on this?
Yeah, it is a resolution, so clerk Retire is yes. Trustee Marks?
Yes.
Trustee LaRue?
Yes.
Trustee Trescott?
Yes.
Trustee Pompo?
Yes.
Treasurer Johnson?
Yes.
And Supervisor Durant?
Yes.
That motion carries.
It looks like the clerk signs the resolution.
Yep.
Anything else on that?
No, our assessor will be happy.
We'll take that off of our list. Okay, consider budget amendment number 2016-09.
I present to the board budget amendment 2016-09, and I'll give you the highlights of that. Authorization is requested for the fire department water rescue equipment. The offset will come from the fund balance. Also requested is $10,000 for a stormwater plan review on several projects. The offset will come also from the fund balance. I make a motion to approve that budget amendment.
Support.
Motion and support. Questions? Yeah, Dave, did you want to have add anything, or are you here for questions, or? Okay.
You had asked for 10B, didn't you, to speak at that?
Did we get the wrong number?
Did we get the wrong number?
Yeah, I meant the wrong number, 10D.
10D.
I thought he said that.
The D, up road.
Question on the stormwater review, can you, are we going to be recoup any of this, or this is a cost to us?
No, some of these will be recouped. As you'll recall, the fee structure, it goes into an escrow account, and the Public Works will draw on that. We're incurring the cost and then draw on the escrow account to cover the costs.
I think we've already had one payment, if I saw right in the bills.
Yes.
For $3,800, I think, to, oh, I forgot, somebody that we had to pay.
The engineers.
Yeah, yep. And then we get that reimbursed. That's part of like the Jandron thing that we want to look at.
Okay.
The scale.
And the fire department was the $7,500 we approved for the water rescue equipment.
Everybody remembers that. Motion and support. This is a roll call as well.
Clerk Retire is yes. Trustee Marks?
Yes.
Trustee Trescott?
Yes.
Trustee LaRue?
Yes.
Trustee Pompo?
Yes.
Treasurer Johnson?
Yes.
And Supervisor Durant?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you for that. 10C is consider liquor license for 888 Queen LLC. Thinking that might be Manager Girard.
Yeah, this is an application for a liquor license, and I'm not sure that a liquor license is available within the township. We've been taken out of that process. If you'll recall, about a year and a half ago, the state of Michigan changed their licensing requirements for the liquor licenses. We have a finite number of liquor licenses that are available in the township, and to my knowledge, all of those are spoken for, unless this 888 Queen is in the process of purchasing one from an already existing business, and we don't know that. We won't know that until the application is acted on by the Liquor Control Commission.
And even though we don't have any say anymore, they do notify us ahead of time.
Right. The only opportunity we have to comment is if the location is in violation of our ordinances or within so many feet of a church or a school. And that's really the only comment. We make that to the Liquor Control Commission. It's not a decision on our part.
I saw hands. Yes, Dan.
just a question. I believe that we did have an extra one that was going to Chili's that never came to fruition, so they gave us an extra one.
It came back to the board for the UP Sportsplex,
yeah,
about
isn't
three
this
or
the
four
same
meetings ago, and it was redelegated.
Isn't this the same thing?
It's redoubt. No, this is not. This is a different business.
Oh, I thought this was for the UP Sportsplex.
Oh,
okay.
This is 888 Queen LLC, and I'm not sure what that is, but the license was reallocated to the UP Sportsplex.
So
go ahead, John.
The only involvement we have at this point is to make the decision whether or not it meets our limited qualifications.
Right.
Does it?
This location is on U.S. 41. It's the former Chinese restaurant that had the fire recently.
Okay. So what remains for this board to do would be to
submit it.
Is submit it, but I think with a qualification that it...
Oh, we do. We fill out a piece of the form that identifies us not in violation of any of our ordinances. The only issue is there a license that's available, or are they purchasing one from somebody else? But we do. We fill out a portion of it that certifies that it's in compliance with our ordinances. Does take a board action, however.
We don't need action right now, right?
We do have to.
Oh, we do?
This is a resolution, so.
Okay.
Well, this is simply an approval.
Okay.
We're approving them submitting the license.
I'll make the motion that we consent with the approval of the requested license.
I'll second.
Motion and support. Any further discussion or questions?
This is actually a resolution, so that will be a roll call vote.
Okay.
And hearing no other questions, Trustee Marks?
Yes.
Trustee LaRue?
Yes.
Trustee Trescott?
Yes.
Trustee Pompo?
Yes.
Treasurer Johnson?
Yes.
Clerk Quartari is yes, and Supervisor Durant?
Yes.
Motion carries. I'll get this form filled out tomorrow.
And if you'll note on the second page, they are indicating they're requesting a new license. So there doesn't look like they are acquiring one from somebody else. So, and I don't believe there is one available.
Thank you.
But that doesn't affect us.
No, does
so.
Not.
That's just a liquor bureau.
Okay. Consider Planning Commission recommendation to Township Board regarding proposed off-road vehicle ordinance, Marquette Township. Did you want to talk about this first, Dave, or were you here to answer questions? Or
I'm here to talk about it, but it's more appropriate that Randy address the
first. Okay.
The actual recommendation from the Planning Commission.
Well,
unless you want me to read it.
Well, if you want to, you can read it if you want. I mean.
All right, as you recall, the board requested the Planning Commission research an ORB ordinance for the township. The Planning Commission requested from the Road and Rec Committees that they research and come back with recommendations for an ORB ordinance to the township. That has all been done back to the Planning Commission. And did everybody get the memorandum from the Planning Commission?
We did.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't really need to read that.
Shouldn't.
A couple things I wanted to point out. It's not as easy as adopting the Marquette County Ordinance, because inside of the Marquette County Ordinance, it's a four-page ordinance. On page 2, in section 2, there is an exception for the ORV operating in the township, and in the exception, paragraph A, well, it reads, an ORV may be operated on the far right of the maintained portion of a road within the county with these exceptions, and under A, roads within the Charter Township of Chocolate, the Charter Township of Marquette, the Township of Sands, and the cities of Marquette, the Gawney, and they're excluded from that, so you can't operate them. So the county would need to go in and remove the Charter Township of Marquette from their ordinance before it would apply. Otherwise, there's a conflict there. If you look over on, well, if you don't have this copy, but on page 3 of the Marquette County ORV ordinance, there was two recommendations that came out of the road rec and planning groups. That number one recommended a speed of no more than 15 miles per hour within the Charter Township of Marquette. And the other recommendation was that they wouldn't operate between the hours of 8, they would only operate between the hours of 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. So there'd be no operations from 10 p.m. until 8 a.m. the next morning. If you wanted to apply those two recommendations to an ordinance, you could either do an ordinance through the Planning Commission, or the county could include those two exceptions in their ordinance when they redo it, removing Marquette Township as one of the accepted townships. I would think, in the spirit of cooperation, it would be easier just to do it through the county, and then the township could, as soon as the county removed their exception for Marquette Township, the ordinance would be applicable to Marquette Township. And there was a big discussion about whether the county would go along with opening the roads up in Marquette Township to ORVs. And I did find another part on section 2, or page 2, section 3, that reads, pursuant to MCL, a big long number, the township board of a township in the county may adopt an ordinance to close any roads within the boundaries of the township to the operation of ORVs permitted by this ordinance. The next sentence says, the township of a township in the county may adopt an ordinance authorizing the operation of ORVs on the maintained portion of one or more roads located within the township. So that's, they really can't tell us no. It's a matter of what the board wants to do.
Randy, did you want to add anything?
Oh, I think what Dave is saying is accurate. Basically, the township historically has had two options. Well, actually, three options. One is to adopt the state ORV ordinance, and if the county has adopted a separate ordinance, to adopt that ordinance, or thirdly, to establish their own ordinance. And basically what this board, the prior boards, have done historically is to take a position that the roads within Trowbridge in particular are not appropriate to have ORVs mixed on the paved portion of the road with traffic because of the narrowness of the roads. So typically, the township has rejected the county ordinance and fell under the state ordinance. Not adopted your own ordinance, but fell under the state. And basically, the state ordinance says that you cannot operate unless there's a shoulder, and we have no shoulders. So what if the board wants to modify the ordinance, Dave is right, what has to happen is you have to notify the county that you wish to adopt their ordinance with certain codicils, basically. And those codicils would be that you want a different speed limit and that you want specified hours of operation, and then the county would amend their ordinance to reflect that. But you will have to be prepared to address the traffic questions that will come as a result of it.
John, did you have something?
I thank the Recreation Committee, the Road Committee, and the Planning Commission for all the information they've forwarded to us. And obviously, enforcing a specific roads ordinance is fraught with problems. So I move to concur with the recommendation forwarded by the planner, Zoning Administrator Jason McCarthy.
Support.
Motion and support. Discussion?
I wouldn't be in favor of the 15 mile an hour or the hours, because in the summertime people go out. Sometimes they want to go out early in the morning, and at 10 o'clock it's still light out at night. So I would probably go a little later, you know, 7 to 11 or something like that.
Be cautious about complaints of violating the noise ordinance, which is at 10 o'clock curfew.
Yeah, that was how the committees come up at 10 o'clock.
Well, then what about the motorbikes and stuff like that? The scooters and that.
Same.
We were asked to look at an ORV ordinance.
they are subject to being ticketed after 10 o'clock by the Sheriff's Department. Yeah.
Manistee could try to do something similar to this. They went at their own, but then they went back to the, they tried to restrict what streets they could go to on, and after that, they just went back with the county ordinance, and they had no problems. It's our officers that will do the correcting, and if they're violators, they'll do it. But I would just stick with the same thing with the county has 25, and I wouldn't put the 8 to 10. So
they question do. On the motion.
That's what you're doing?
I'm questioning the motion. Okay. We're having discussion. That's what it's for, and that's what my discussion is.
Any other?
That's why I would vote against it.
I think you're kind of forgetting what our street structure looks like. If you're even comparing us to the city of Manistee, they probably have real roads and real sidewalks and ditches and everything else that we don't have. Think about how people would try to get around. What if they want to go down Ontario? That's a county road, but we have no shoulder, so now you have an unlicensed maybe younger child going up and down roads, especially, you know, Ontario's a good example because everybody knows it. I'm concerned about having, one of the things that the Complete Streets idea and everything that Mike talked about is having some kind of a connection so that if they want to go out in the woods, that's different. I don't know that we have, and we've had some discussion about some kind of a throughway. What street could they use to get to a trail or something like that? I just don't want us to be too quick to approve something that says, yes, we're going to let all of these vehicles basically on the roads. They're going to have to be on the roads in most of our areas.
They're licensed.
They are, but they're not, you know, they, what do they say, 13 years old and above? Or, I mean, these aren't necessarily, yes, Dave, you're waving, waving at me, okay.
Yeah, within the Marquette County ordinance, there are age restrictions. If you're going to be the solo operator of an ORV on a road, you got to be a licensed driver.
So, but what I'm saying is if we go with the county ordinance or not, we have to remember that some of this stuff is going to, may come back to bite us.
Yeah, and there is another portion of the ordinance is that you can operate it at 12 or above, but you have to be under the direct supervision of a licensed adult.
And they have
And the considerations that we looked at when we come up with the 10 o'clock at night was the noise ordinance. And that would be an issue, and we just couldn't think of a better time to start it in the morning than 8, so.
Okay. Dan?
Since all the township roads are actually county roads, does this mean that they can drive on any township road? In which case, my question would be is, in the township proper, there is no shoulders. They're basically yards. And so, I don't know about anybody else's street, but mine, they go buzzing right down the middle of the street, so. That's my question that happens there.
I think it would still fall, and you can tell me.
They're far right.
It's on the maintained portion of.
But they're aren't they talking about a county road as designated a county road?
No.
Not that they're county roads?
The ordinance addresses roads within the county.
Okay.
Period.
Right. They do exempt some roads. The county primaries and those that are commercial roadways are exempted from the ordinance. But in answer to Trustee Pompous' question, yes, it would be all of the roads in Trowbridge would be available. They would be able to be on the paved portion of the road to the far right. Which doesn't leave a whole lot of room for
cars,
vehicle traffic.
If I could share some of the logic behind that recommendation is when the board first wanted to review this and the Planning Commission directed the committees to review it, it was to select specified roads. But the problem with selecting specified roads is as soon as that's done, you are forcing somebody to break the law. If you're not going to provide a specified area to unload your machine because they got to get to that area somehow. And what you're going to find is either the law enforcement is going to look the other way when they're getting to the road, or you're going to have to force them to break the law. That's why it was just a matter of. And I think the other part of that was if you're putting all of that traffic on one road, you're going to have more complaints from the neighbors that live on that one road. And I don't, it was the committee's consideration that it's not going to be a big issue getting through Trowbridge. They do it now. It just gets ignored for the most part. If you sit over there and we're working on Lions Field, they're going up and down the road, I mean, all the time. So they're doing it now. They're just breaking the law.
Yes, Randy.
So to refresh everyone's memory, the motion is to the Marquette County ordinance should be applied within Marquette Township. And further, within that ordinance, 15 mile an hour speed limit and prohibit the operation between 10 and 8 a.m. at night. Is that it, Dave, basically?
That was the recommendation.
Okay.
That's what we're voting on.
Okay. Pete's question to that was to eliminate what, did you say, Pete?
I would say not the, I wouldn't change the speed limit, 25 miles an hour, and I wouldn't put a time limit on it. The counties have had this for how many years since, I forget when they had it, and it don't seem to be much of an issue. I think if we just adopt theirs as is, And then if we do have a problem, then we correct it like anything else.
Okay. Yes, Dan?
If this is this going to be a resolution, so we're changing the county's resolution, are they going to require a public hearing?
They might.
Well, if we approve this, we'll move this to the county, and then they have to...
They have to amend their ordinance.
Amend their ordinance.
Right, and would that require a public hearing?
It might.
I would think so.
Okay.
They may not want to do it.
Anything else? Did you have something, John?
No, thank you.
Okay. All right, so the motion is going to be to change it to 15 miles an hour and prohibit use between 10 p.m. and 8 a.m., correct?
Yeah, and to the Marquette County ordinance should be applied within Marquette Township.
Okay.
Section 2A would have to remove Marquette Township.
Okay. Go ahead. It's a resolution.
It is not. Oh, it's just a motion that, because we're going to, if we approve it, then the county would have to take action. So it's just a recommendation from us. That's either yay or nay.
So just for clarification, we're not really changing the township ordinance. We're just requesting the county to change their ordinance.
Actually, what you're doing is you are advising the county that the township is now adopting the county ordinance with two alterations. That would be the hours of operation and the speed limit.
And that's just for us.
That's just for us.
The rest of the
participants.
Nope,
that's just for us.
Okay. Then we have to enforce that, or the
sheriff's department,
right? Mm-hmm.
Which is
and
a county agency.
And they'll come back and tell us whether they agree with this or not.
Well, I think Dan's right. I think there will be, they will have to have a public hearing, at least one public hearing at an open meeting for that change, where our residents would have the opportunity to tell the township what their position is, and then they are told the county what their position is, and then the county would either adopt or not adopt and let us know.
So how would we and our residents know about that? How
would
just
it would have to be a published. It would have to be a published public hearing.
We
can find out. I'll find out from Scott Urbish what the process would be, because we're now wanting to be included in the county's ordinance. What does that take in terms of an action?
So at least we'd know too. Okay.
Right.
Good. Okay, that's good information. A roll call vote.
Okay. Trustee Marks?
Yes.
Clerk Retire is yes. Trustee LaRue?
No.
Trustee Trescott?
Yes.
Trustee Pompo?
Yes.
Treasurer Johnson?
Yes.
And Supervisor Durant?
Yes.
That motion carries.
10E is consider Utility Review Committee Annual Report.
There really isn't an action that the board needs to take on this. This is information for the board, and I'm not sure that the board has seen their annual reports in the past.
I've never seen it. No.
Okay, that's why I wanted to bring it to you. The Utility Review Committee is a creature of the 1980s. There was a dispute between the townships and the Board of Light and Power with regard to the rates of electric charges that were being charged to the townships versus the cities. It went through the local courts, went through the Court of Appeals, and ultimately to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court ruled in favor of the townships, ordered the Board of Light and Power to reimburse townships. The Utility Review Committee came about because the townships at the time thought that there was a very good possibility that there may be a repeat of this in the future, so they formed a committee, Utility Review Committee, to put together basically a war chest of funds that if they ever had to go to court again, they would have the money set aside to do that. And that is capped at $142,000. About 3 years ago, how that money got there is they are reimbursed from the BLP based upon the number of electric units, electric meters that are in each of the communities. So once those funds added up to $142,000, which was an arbitrary figure that they had set years ago. Now they do a distribution each year. And that distribution you see coming back, I believe, was around $6,000 for us for this last year. And that's continuing. So every year they do a recalculation of what's been received from the BLP. Anything over 142,000, they redistribute based upon the number of meters. And there's a listing, I think the last page of what's attached here shows you the number of meters in each of the jurisdictions. So this is being forwarded to you for your information. There's no action required on your part. It's basically a report. I didn't think you had seen it in the past, so that's why we put it on as a new business item.
Thank you.
Any questions for the manager?
This goes way back when they first started, yeah.
1980s.
And Randy, you go to those meetings.
It's they meet basically once a year. And it's in June. We just had this meeting in June, and the township supervisor and I'm the alternate township supervisor, is the member, but for this particular meeting, Trustee Durant was not available, so I went.
Another meeting. I asked him to go. Anything else for the manager? Okay, so we can just, this money goes, I'm not sure I'm aware.
Simply goes into the general fund.
Okay.
It's a small piece of the revenue projections that we do.
10F is consider medical marijuana moratorium extension. We've seen this before us quite a few times, and I believe we kind of do it about every 6 months.
Actually, Roger can make comments on this, but this is something, as you know, has been before you several times. And basically when the first referendum election that occurred that created the medical marijuana statute, the communities had the ability to put regulatory guidelines in. This community decided that we did not want to have dispensaries, that we did not want to have those kinds of activities going on in the township, so you adopted a moratorium. And that moratorium was put in place pending legal action and legislative actions that were dealing with appeals and challenges to the referendum. Those are ongoing. They're still going on. So what we've been doing is we've been doing a renewal or a review and a renewal, potentially an extension every 6 months. And last one just expired at the end of July, so this is extending it for another 6 months. And there were several changes that Roger had made because there is new pending legislation, and there is also potential that this is going to be another referendum for recreational use, which would be different than medical marijuana. So with that, I have no more comments.
Very briefly, we've been tracking bills that are pending in both the Michigan House and the Michigan Senate, and it appears that there are actually more bills pending now than there were approximately 6 months ago. The bills keep either getting stuck in committee or get modified reintroduced with additional provisions. There are some pending currently that would invoke a sales tax or an excise tax on marijuana. There are ones that would actually permit a township to prohibit the operation of provisioning centers, which are essentially similar to dispensaries under certain criteria. Until this legislation is passed, it's really premature to try to adopt an ordinance either allowing or disallowing businesses of this nature, because there's no guidance on what the legislation is going to be. So we keep monitoring it fairly closely, hoping that the legislature will move one way or the other, either reject the bills, pass the bills, do something with it, and of course the issue on the referendum is another ongoing one. There's currently a dispute in terms of whether enough signatures were obtained in order to place the referendum on the ballot. And I believe the status of that right now is it's before a court to decide that issue. So we don't even have that resolved yet. This is actually a 7-month one through the end of February, only with the rationale that it's probably going to be at least the end of the year, January 1, before anything would be determined. And even if something is determined, it's probably going to take another 6 weeks or so to just sort through what has been adopted, or rejected in order to do something intelligent in terms of adopting an ordinance or taking action.
Any questions? Yes, John.
Move to reinstitute the medical marijuana moratorium extension.
Second.
Motion and support. Any questions for legal counsel or anything? Okay, we have a resolution. You want a roll call?
Trustee Marks?
Yes.
Trustee LaRue?
Yes.
Trustee Pompo?
Yes.
Trustee Trescott?
Yes.
Treasurer Johnson?
Yes.
And Supervisor, or Clerk Ratari? And I'm a yes, and Supervisor Durant?
Yes.
Almost forgot myself. Motion carries.
Okay, thank you for that. Manager's report.
Pretty straightforward report. I really don't have anything to add to the printed report, but I did want to make it just a couple of comments. Number one, on the form that Supervisor Durant spoke about earlier with the regard to calculating the millages, for residents that are interested in determining before getting into the ballot box what millages they wish to support and how much financial impact that would be on them, a sample ballot for us. When would a sample ballot be available? I know they put it up in the Secretary of State's
It'll probably website. Be mid-September, because our absentees have to go out by sometime in September, so I can let the residents know when it's available, and we'll put it on our website.
So you could easily go and see what all of the questions are that are going to be on the November ballot and how many mills that would add up to for all of those that you want to support. Then you would look at your tax bill to determine what your taxable value of your home is, and it'll have two figures on there. It'll have a figure of assessed value and then a figure of taxable value, which is basically 50% of the assessed value. It's the taxable value that you would use to look at this chart. And basically what that will do, will give you the opportunity to make your selections of what you would choose to support in millages, add up the number of mills that comes to, look at the chart based upon what your taxable value is, and that's how much you would be adding to your expenses. And the reason we're doing this is because there are so many questions out there, and there are so many other things that are happening, like the increases in utility bills, a variety of things that are going on. We're concerned that some residents may tax themselves basically to a point where they can't afford to do anything any longer. So we want to try and avoid that kind of a situation and make people a little more conscious about what their choices are and their selections are. So that was a comment on that. The only other comment that I would like to make is I just wanted to thank those members of the fire department that volunteered to cover the operations while we had the folks at tournaments. I think there were about eight, Dan? Was it about eight members that went? Six? Okay. While those six were not available, so we did have staff coverage. Other than that, I really didn't have anything else to add.
Anything for the manager? Yes, John.
I thank the manager for what's going on and the aid to help our taxpayers. But there's a part of it that we don't address that I'd like to plant the seed that perhaps we can think of a way to aid them further. And that's that many of our taxpayers have a mortgage. They don't see their tax bill. They don't know what it is, and they don't know what question to ask. I wonder if we can't find some way where if they were to come here or phone here and give an address, we could tell them what the assessment is.
That's a good point.
And if we can do that, we can then take that next step that's being offered and aid them in a way that they've never been aided before. And I think we can have a more intelligent electorate coming in November. And I think we ought to do that. Even if it costs us some money to provide somebody to respond to those questions.
Actually, we have that capability right now. Anybody can either come into the office or call the office, and either to the assessor or any one of the staff in the office have access to that tax information that could tell them, and you're absolutely right, if you have a mortgage that's in escrow, you don't ever see the tax bill.
But we got to communicate.
Yeah, and they can also, if they don't want to call and talk to somebody, they can come into the front desk, and we have a terminal at the front desk that they can look up their own tax information on that terminal. So that's already there.
But I think that we would be providing a real service if we communicated that in a greater way than we're doing now.
Mm-hmm.
Thank
so
you.
So maybe we can add that to
we
the
We can
next
add
one.
That to the, what utility. Bill would it be? It would be the October. September. I'm sorry, the September bill.
Yeah, we can do a blurb of information
right.
that came up probably a year ago.
And if we know the date that the sample ballots are available, we could put that on the same notice.
Yeah, maybe in October we can put the sample ballot in too.
Nope, that's going to be quite large.
So
it's going to be big. It's going to be a long ballot.
It's just the millage question.
They're going to be long because the questions themselves
true,
are going to
yeah.
be long.
I would just suggest we put a link to where they can
yeah.
find it.
Yep.
Pay to. Whatever it takes.
Yeah, a couple of those questions are going to be lengthy questions.
Thanks for bringing that up again, John. I totally forgot about that. Ernie?
I'm following up on that same area that... when they send in for their taxes, which is the next one, we're doing some of that by the September 15th. You have to have it completed for a summer one. But the biggest push is when they comes in at the year end
mm-hmm.
and that. And that's when the escrow accounts start pouring in. And usually they send them in, and we may have 200 or 300 from a financial
right.
institution at one time. And there may be 3 or 4 different financial institutions that we get it from. So there's a tremendous amount of people out there that have escrow accounts. So
yeah.
getting information to them is great. It's trying to get them to now take the next step to actually go out and ask the question on that too.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, you're talking about maybe Wells Fargo or something holds mortgages on 100
yeah.
of our residents or something. So they just dump all that money to the township in one lump sum. And like we said before, the resident doesn't even see it. Came up with my daughter. That's how we start talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
I was, you know, yelling at her about voting. She goes, "Mom, I don't even see my tax bill." And I went, "Duh."
But, you know, actually, you could take your prior year's total tax that we can give with the total. It's going to be close. It's not going to be significant. I mean, the taxes aren't going to go up that much. So we could do that. We could give the total taxes from the prior year now. At least be a ballpark, it'd be close.
Basically, we can help them figure
yeah,
this
the
out.
The biggest thing is getting them interested enough to take that step to ask the question.
Mm-hmm.
I think when they get their next electric bill, that'll be enough of a boost to get them interested. Because I got mine.
October.
I got mine. No, I already got mine.
Did you? Well, good.
I already got mine. It went up quite a bit.
Keep going up, too. Anything else for the manager?
I have one question.
Sure, go ahead.
In the fire report, it was reported that we have 2 new volunteer fire people that passed their fire training 1 and 2. Dan Anderson and Jesse Nye, is it?
Nye. You'll be
yeah.
seeing them at your August 16th meeting.
That's good. That's good to see that.
Okay. Anything else for the manager? Okay. And we're down to the fire department liaison, which was added on tonight, and I did give you a rough rationale for why we're looking at this, because it's coming to the time of making appointments pretty soon, and you have the history in front of you. I don't know if you've had a chance to read it, but I agree with the manager that the liaison appointment to the fire department be eliminated, just so it's one less thing we need to have on our plates. Comments, suggestions? Yes, Dan.
Actually, I couldn't agree more with the removal of the liaison for the fire department. I go back to when I was in the department for as long as I was in the department, and I never understood the reasoning to have when Clerk Musoff became the rationale eluded me as well as many other people, because the minutes were always given to the board. So if there was any questions, we did have a chief and assistant chief that could be contacted. You know, obviously they weren't a full time, but they were still the chief and assistant chief. So I never really understood the reasoning, the rationale at all for the liaison. So as far as I'm concerned, it's don't have a problem whatsoever with that.
Okay.
Well, I'll move that we eliminate the position because I was that position one time, and I've been here since 2004, and I agree with Dan. I mean, that we get the minutes of their meeting. There's really no reason to have someone there and waste kind of an evening out of their busy schedule as it is. I know it was tough for me at times to go because they meet on Monday nights all the time, and you know, I had meeting at other things going, and it was tough to get there a couple times a month. So I move to remove the position.
I'll second it.
Motion and second. Any other comments, Pete? Did you have anything to add?
No, I just think that that department head reports to the manager through the and the supervisor, and the way our structure is, that should be enough. Ron, our chief, will come in and give us a report maybe once a month. I think that's important that he does that. And I think that should suffice our, like you say, plus we have reports, you know, every meeting, so or once a month. So I think it's the right thing to do.
Yes.
Following up on Pete, I think if we can set up some kind of a schedule for the fire chief to come in on a monthly basis, something like that, and then be done with it, and we'll go from there.
Yep. Let's see. Yep, I can talk to him. Anything else? Yeah, I only have seven people, basically. I would say six, because I have different meetings I need to go to draw from for these resources. So I hated to, I don't want to say waste a person, but there's other stuff we really need to be covering that isn't, the information's not out there as readily. So I appreciate that. So we have a motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you for that. Yes, Randy.
I'm sorry, but there was one other item that I was going to mention. You very briefly, you already noted in the budget amendment that we transferred the funds for the water equipment. We now have all of the equipment. The truck is equipped. It's ready to go. But the positive thing on it is, I don't know if any of you caught the small article that was in the paper about a week ago, that the impetus is spreading, and they're now talking about adding the rescue stations to the beaches along M28 as well. So that's all a good thing. But mm-hmm. from our standpoint, we are now fully capable for the rescue response.
Thank you.
Yes, Pete.
Could I ask manager one more question? Sure. On meters changed over, how do we stand on the meter change?
Water meters? Oh, yeah.
I'm
not sure what the actual percentage is, but they've been continually changing out meters when they get into people's homes. I can find out and transmit that information to board members. Well, I can just send you an email, let you know how many meters, where we are on that changeover. What Trustee LaRue is talking about is changing over from the old Badger meters to the new digital meters, water meters.
Anything else?
Motion to adjourn.
Hey.
A little early yet.
Yeah, wait till 8:30.
We're just trying to
do public comment first, though.
Just pushing.
There might be somebody that wants to ask a question or make a statement. We don't want to.
No, that is out of order. For right now.
Yes. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
And Sherry, if you would hold that microphone close to your mouth so the people can hear you. And don't eat it, but close to your mouth.
Close.
Sherry Johnson, 2272 Cherry Street. I'm glad that Dave told us when our roads are going to be getting done. I have a concern, though. I haven't gotten any, of course, we haven't gotten the letters. In my home, I have a disabled person. I don't know if the road is going to be blocked for the full day because home health comes in to take care of him. So I would have to let them know that they could not go on our road. And that's a big concern because he's got Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. So I do need the help in there for him.
You can? Okay.
I can address that, Sherry, because I did have the same concern, and I talked to Mark Davitello about that. And they are going to keep on the township part of the road project, they will keep a lane accessible while they are working on the road. So you will be able to access that road while they're working. So the road, because we're going to have the same issue with the schools and the school buses, because because it's going to be during that time they're going to be constructed while their bus routes are also. So there will, the road will be passable while being resurfaced and constructed. So you shouldn't have any problems. That's what I've been told, so.
And if you do, let us know.
Good, thanks for that. We typically don't do that interaction at this point, but I just want to make sure that the public understands that we don't usually answer questions, but we did, just so it doesn't get carried away later. Anybody else? Are we good? Any more board member comment? Yes, Randy.
I forgot in the first board member comment, but the Planning Commission meeting last time, we did, as Dave stated, we did talk about the ORV ordinance and I'd recommend that to the board. We did have the kind of a long discourse about the design standard, and we're trying to compromise between developers and townships, so hopefully we're going to get to that point. And we finished up the CIP, and you should probably be seeing at your next board meeting a recommendation from the Planning Commission for the CIP. So that should be kind of on a little late, but on schedule for a budget.
Yes, Pete.
Just want to let the people know that no matter what happens and whatever happens in the township, this is their township. And they have to feel free, if they have a question, to call the township. So many times that people say, well, I've been waiting to find out this or that. And just call a township and they'll get your answers. We have a nice young lady who answers the phone and she'll direct it in your question and get an answer for you. Mm-hmm. So just, I want to feel comfortable in doing that and said, oh, I don't want to bother. Well, you don't bother because this is your township.
Yep, so, we all work for the public.
Right, so I just want to feel free to call and ask questions. And so, thank you.
Randy.
And one more statement. I think tonight's meeting was very good. We got a lot accomplished in an hour and a half, and we kept it below 2 hours because some members have talked to me, not from the board, but of the residents, as after 2 hours, they lose a lot of interest. So if we can keep our meetings under 2 hours, I think that's going to be helpful moving in the future. And I guess if we don't have anything else, I can't say that because you have to move to the next one. I would move to adjourn.
So
early supper. Or,
nope, we're good. We're good. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? 8:34.
Congratulations.
Thank you.